Well, my early days goes back to 1941, which is, you know, the time of the 78s and the time of, it was really coming out of the, or being and still in the big band era, the pre-war big band era, the popularity of big band music and all that. And then the music stores of that time were not much. There weren't very many unique music stores, a bunch of maybe tiny ones, and then the music was generally sold in either record departments of department stores or music stores that carried instruments and sheet music and all of that. The unique dedicated record store was a sort of just emerging, I guess, at that time. And of course, during the war, they all sort of flattened out and nothing much happened. But after the war, slowly the industry began to get its footing again. Manufacturing of product regained itself, and the music itself began to change. I think mainly because of the popularity of the big bands during the 30s and 40s. Went away because the big bands, when they came back from the war, couldn't travel anymore, and therefore they were more or less disbanded for the most part. And as a result, music sort of went into some evolutionary changes, along with a mixture of populations and what have you that took place in the world. But at that time in the By the time the 50s came around, by the emergence of one-stops and rack jobbers and things like that began to happen, as well as the strengthening, I guess, of the labels. That was the early times. And then I think the development of the new technologies in 1949 and 50 made a huge change, too, which was, the introduction of the 45, and the introduction of the LP, which changed the way people listened to music in their homes, improved the quality of what they listened to, and all those things, which I think are very, very important. My dad was in the drugstore business, and we just put a record department in the drugstore, which by itself was pretty rare. I mean, the whole idea, the music companies, music companies in the early days, the big labels always set themselves up on a pedestal a little bit and looked down their noses at their customers. So the idea that a drugstore would have the pertinence, if you will, to go in the record business was a little bit shocking to them. But they went along with the gag. And as far as I was concerned, it was just it was a place to work. And, we had fun. We had really had fun. That's one of the sad parts about the overall industry today is not any fun. During the wonderful times from the 60s to the 90s, it was great. Everybody was having a ball. Was that people replaced their collections. If they were a collector before that, except for the real people who were collectors of a very special nature who wanted them on 78s or wanted all the LPs or whatever, but basically people who had small collections of the kind of music they liked, they not only bought the new releases that were released on CD by the artists and music they liked, but they also replaced a lot of the music that they had already. On LP. And the CD certainly was a much better product than that which preceded it. We had an attitude about that local management, local responsibility, we wanted our people that worked for us to be, it was their store, not my store, not a corporation's store, that sort of thing. It wasn't in the early days, especially, and up till the end, up till near the end, because I think that's one of the things that kind of destroyed us. was the drift towards centralization of management. Well, the Sports Arena store was an incredible store. It was real small by comparison, but my God, what they did in there was just a kick. And it was because of the people that ran it down there that was made it eat. Well, all the stores were pretty much like that. I think that was one of the more special ones because they compressed all of that stuff into that 7,000 feet and just piled it in vertically and horizontally and every other way, and then all the people were into it. And they were the ones that did it. It wasn't us up here in Sacramento that were telling them exactly what to do. They were the ones in the store down there, and the store's all over for that matter. Our attitude was to carry as much as possible, and the companies helped us a lot in making sure we had it. Of course, there's also something else to be said, too, and that is back, that store particularly opened in 1972, I think, and during that, in the 70s and 80s and 90s, there was a lot less available, surprisingly. You'd think it would be just the opposite than what's been thrown out into the marketplace and produced for the marketplace in the last, say, 5 years or 4 years, where just an avalanche of new materials being recorded because of the ease in making records, the ease in digging old stuff up and reissuing it and so on. There's so damn much more out there that really becomes very difficult to put it all in one place except on a list. We would buy practically everything that was released because you only had to buy one of it or something like that. It wasn't that difficult. And maybe there were 20 or 30,000, well, in those days, probably only 10 or 15,000 new releases a year. So it wasn't that hard to do. But again, as time went on and as more and more companies went into business, that became more difficult. Unfortunately, like the music industry, the record industry made a terrible mistake. They reduced the profit margin, the normal profit margin that was on LPs and 45s. Remember the idea that it costs more to produce the CD and all that. And as a result, they kind of changed the dynamics, the financial dynamics of the industry, because it was true when CDs first came out, they were expensive to produce. But as time got on, or went on, the cost of producing and manufacturing the CD went down and down. But instead of those savings being passed along to the dealers and the public, both prices were raised, and through a long period of time, prices went up to a level of which became a little bit untenable. And at the same time, why they took one of the most important elements of the retail music business out of the market later on, they took away singles, which was a terrible mistake on the part of the record industry. And therefore, if you listen to a new song or a new record of some sort and liked it, you couldn't buy it unless you bought the whole CD. And that was ridiculously expensive, you know, for the one song that you wanted. So you chased an awful lot of people out of the buying market. And ultimately, you know, we're jumping forward a lot, but we chased a lot of people out of the buying market into the free downloading market, which really changed everything a lot. How do you compete with free? And then the technology itself and the way people, young people especially, listen to music change. So it was a case of you're listening to music on your computer or later on listening to music on your iPod and things like that. That made a pretty dramatic difference as well. But even so, I look back at the major record labels and big businesses that ran these labels as being, sowing seeds of their own destruction because of a kind of a selfishness on their part. like anybody in the entertainment business, you know, they don't think forward beyond, they don't think for the future. They think only in terms of what can be achieved quickly, you know. And so it, they're not saying what we're doing here is going to maybe destroy our market by, you know, destroying these young people growing up and keep buying it. We're going to get more money out of them now. And, you know, we're going to make more money. And the truth of it is they did. They did. They made a lot of money. If you want to sell something, you want to give it away, that's another matter. But if you want to sell something, you got to engage young people and get them into buying your product as opposed to, you know, chasing them somewhere else. Well, they hated it. Well, they ultimately did shut Napster down. He had Kazaa, he had LimeWire, and he had a million other ones. So once the genie was out of the bottle, as they say, there wasn't much you could do. They really tried. The manufacturing people didn't understand it all that much. And they were confused, and maybe none of us did. Who knows? Again, it's probably from my viewpoint that you had to keep focusing on something you were going to sell young people, because old people just grow up and die. Older people are a huge part right now of percentage-wise of the record-buying market today. But if you don't keep bringing the young people into the market, you don't have a future. Don't forget, the record companies it's really a people business. A lot of the talent has been fired out of the record companies. They're not out there. They became too expensive, perhaps, for the record companies. They had to go off on their own. The great A&R people sort of disappeared. Another element of the whole sales forces and effort to make something happen and expose things, all of the marketing departments of these companies are all gone. There's nobody there. It's still they're trying to make money off of a business, but all of this experienced talent is gone, and the new talent that they're developing, or the new talent that's being developed by itself, is just not getting it yet. But again, it's part of the problem is you don't have a marketplace to sell to. You got a virtual marketplace through the internet, what have you, which has been entirely useless, but you don't have a retail marketplace to sell to. There's no customers out there. There's no place to test anything. A lot of the times, the real success with music in the 60s, and later on, certainly the 70s, were the social implications of the music, the importance of the music as reacting to what was going on in the world, both socially and both economically and politically and all that stuff. So it was something to talk about, you know, and the messages of a great many of the songs were important to people. I'm not sure that the messages, you know, possibly being crude here, or cruel perhaps, self-analysis type of messages and songs is not as nice as the messages that came before. You know, when you're in 60 years or so, you kind of see a lot of things, trends develop and trends go away and so on. Usually they didn't last all that long. I mean, rock and roll lasted a long time. Music lasts forever. All those things are good, but somehow or another, a popularity trend sort of came and went. The doo-wop of the 50s, you know, the disco of that period, and so on. I was surprised when rap and hip hop, although hip hop certainly an important dance type of music and a lot of fun, but I was surprised that rap and that whole style of music hung on for so long. It's beginning to kind of wane a little bit now, but this is 20 years of it. It kind of surprised me a little bit that happened. certainly touch people. You can't ever say that movement, musical movement, didn't touch an awful lot of people and they really heard it clearly. But I'm surprised that it hung on and something new hasn't caught. The great fusion, don't forget, that started in the 30s and 40s and 50s, the fusion of the regional music in America, which was, of course, came from the fusion of European music or Northern European music. Well, you'd have to say there's a fusion from all music coming from all over the world. But you had that fusion of country music and R&B, more or less black music, which created rock and roll, rockabilly rock and roll. And then the message that you could hang on top of that, the words message you could hang on top of that, those rhythms and so on, the appeal, the dance appeal and all that stuff. The folk music fusion into it and all of those kinds of things. Whether there's any of these streams of music coming up out of places around the country, one of the things that I was able to do, and recognizing that we're fountainheads of music, when we were developing all through that period, we go to the places like Nashville and New Orleans and Atlanta and New York and Philadelphia and Chicago and San Francisco and Portland, Seattle, all the big cities, okay? They had these little fountains of music which spurted up and they become centers which then spread to the rest of the country. I'm not sure there are any place in the country right now where there is a fountain of music. Now, maybe I just not seeing it. I don't see it all of a sudden coming out of someplace. All the musical streams that happened in America did start from someplace, you know? They really did. I mean, you think about it, Muscle Shoals or Memphis, and certainly what was happening in rock in the early 60s in San Francisco, which was, you know, and Los Angeles a little later on, was miracles. But you had people who discovered new music or what was happening, not necessarily new music, but just what was happening musically in a particular place, we'll say Chicago or Austin, Texas or something. Okay, now you had a record industry they could sell to. They discovered this music. They got it out around their area, these small record labels that developed through the 40s and 50s and 60s, and not too much in the 30s, but because that was so depressed, but the late 40s, I'd say, in 50s and 60s, possibly as much as the 70s, they'd start up these, they'd find this music, they'd create it, and then they'd go out and sell it. There was a place to sell it too. There were record stores, there were chains of record stores, it started from a small circle around, we'll say, one city or another. In many cases, it was a big city like Los Angeles and New York, but it would start, or Chicago, they would start from that, they would get it out, and they would get it out, and it would spread and spread and spread by way of exploited by radio, because radio would take it on, it wouldn't be happened from one programmer in Fort Worth, Texas, programming the world. It would be a bunch of programmers programming in every city in the country. That process, where you had a whole bunch of different people creating a piece of music or record or recording, and then going out and selling it slowly around the country till it caught on, if it did catch on. On because everything catches on because it's good, and if it isn't good, it doesn't catch on. That's it. Then a lot of people sort of copied it, and you had a movement going for a while, and then the movement would peter out, and something new would come in. Where did we lose that? Well, two things happened. One, the internet and Napster, and that whole bunch of free downloading, and that changed to make it free. And the other, the withdrawal of single songs from the retail marketplace. Those two things, I think, created this huge change. That people were able to get their musical fix with such low quality, it always surprised me. I always thought there was a drift towards. It's another funny thing that happened. As some of the companies, Sony especially, developed higher quality products, you know, there were higher quality CDs, then the market, they dropped it. They had the technology to make a better product and then dropped it. Didn't try to go anywhere with it.